I found out about high sensitivity when I was in high school. And to me, it suddenly clicked very much what I was experiencing, because at least the way I learned about it was as though I would be missing a filter on any sensory or emotional information coming in. And then I realized actually, whoa, this is making me actually so tired during the day.
My name is Corina Greven, and I'm a professor at the Department of Cognitive Neuroscience at the Radboud University, and I hold a chair in environmental sensitivity and health. So in science, we actually have a different term for HSP. We call it sensory processing sensitivity, abbreviated SPS. And in essence, this refers to a trait, and in the scientific literature, we place it as a personality trait that has to do with how people differ in their sensitivity to environmental influences, positive and negative environments. According to science, there are several key characteristics for being sensitive, so it's a particular way of being sensitive. And the first one has to do with being more sensitive to subtleties in your environment, so being more sensitive to nuances, and this can be nuances in terms of what you hear, or what you see, or what you smell, but people also report being more attuned to nuances, for example, in facial expressions of somebody and emotions.
Sometimes I recognize myself in subtle stimuli, especially noise, like now I hear
the radiator.
When I'm tired or something, it can cause some overstimulation. Small ticking, that kind of noises. Smell, and subtle smell that's always there can be overstimulating. It's especially my hearing.
Okay. A second key facet is being more emotionally responsive, both in terms of feeling the negative emotions more, but also positive emotions.
Well, I had a little girl actually who suffered from a certain kind of cancer, and we thought we were not able to cure her at all. We expected that it would come back within a couple of weeks. And actually she is stable for a while. And the first time I did an ultrasound on her, and it didn't come back. I was sitting there and crying. It's still, it's a 7-year-old, blonde, little, nice girl. And it's so, I was so relieved that it didn't return, because we felt we had no chance of treating her adequately. I was sitting there crying when I was doing the ultrasound there.
Empathy is also part of it. And here there are different components of empathy. So there's emotional empathy that has to do with feeling with the other person. So if somebody is sad, you're feeling sad with them. If they're happy, you're feeling happy with them. But also, science seems to suggest, I mean, there's better evidence for this, that cognitive empathy is also related to being more highly sensitive. So cognitive empathy has to do with being able to place yourself in somebody else's shoes, being able to take perspective and make reasonable hypotheses what somebody might be thinking or feeling.
Yeah, absolutely. I find it both a nice thing to have, and also a burden, I guess I would say. I experience it a lot with my friends that they very easily tell me if they are experiencing something difficult or if they need support or advice. And I'm really happy that they feel safe enough to share things like that with me.
No, I have to say, when I started to being empathic to myself, it was also very okay to to use that trait in work. And it's also the reason why I started coaching. Because, well, it's the main trait why people feel seen, feel heard. I think it's the most beautiful trait to have, because when you feel for yourself and feel for other people, for me it's love, and I think the world needs much more of it, so I relate to it, I love it.
Next key characteristic has to do with what's called depth of processing. In terms of people's behaviors, it's often expressed in being more balanced in your decision making, for example, weighing all the pros and cons. It may also mean that you take longer to make decisions.
Sensing and feeling deeply, and it's almost like you see, like you perceive the world on a different level.
Whenever a stimuli come to me, I process it all, actually. There's nothing that gets skipped or something. So it all comes to the core of my being, actually. And as a result of that, I feel more empathy with people. I can sense in which mood they are, or when they actually say yes, they actually mean no, things like that. It makes it all more easy.
It can also be expressed as rumination. And it depth of processing may involve something that is called the default mode network. Again, we need better evidence to back this up. But what we now think is it may have to do with this default mode network, this region of brain networks that's active together when you are busy with internal mentation processes. So for example, thinking about the future, the past, or relating outside information to yourself, something that's called self-referential processing. And the final component of sensitivity is overstimulation, being more easily overstimulated. And that can be expressed in several different ways.
I recognize being overstimulated, especially when I work in bigger organizations. But also when there's a lot going on in my life, I feel easily overstimulated, and I notice higher stress levels.
So when sensory information I'm receiving is coming to me in harmony, like a musical, music in harmony, like a beautiful music playing on, no matter how intense or how loud it is, I can really appreciate that. But if the sensory information I'm receiving is really chaotic, no harmony in it, then I can totally be killed out. Like for example, if I have people visiting my home with many children, then I can like easily become exhausted within an hour. Then I'm done. Because there's no, I have to think about, and I cannot ignore some signals and focus on the other. It's just like all equally coming in, and therefore I'm like completely exhausted in a chaotic sensory environment.
Generally, that things easily get too much for you. You easily feel overwhelmed by them, but it can also be expressed in somatic symptoms, so feeling fatigued or maybe experience a headache or concentration problems or easily. Science actually doesn't say a lot yet about how sensitive people can adjust their lifestyles to the sensitivity.
What I mostly do is that I just see the struggles. So for instance, when I'm at my work, which right now is very social work, where I interact a lot with people, well, on my first working day after vacation, I had a working slot, and then we had a break, and I stayed there with my colleagues, which was super nice, and they are very friendly, and it was just cool to do. And then I went to the second shift, and I couldn't concentrate anymore because it was just too much social stuff, and like it felt like my brain didn't have like a moment to reset. So, and on the second day I did differently and I went outside for a walk, like without music and without my phone and just a walk and food, and it went better.
At this point, I make my life very, it fits my needs. So my daily work is never overstimulating me because I can make my own agenda.
I mean, it's so nice that you can feel things, so that so much stronger than rationally understanding things. And when I'm doing my photography, I'm just happy because I can feel how I should, you know, compose the image, and then I get good images. I should just join the photo club, and I'm sort of creating good photographs. I mean, it's really okay. So that makes me happy because I can feel it, and I don't have to think about it. And feeling things makes life much easier. And being able to feel others makes me happy. And I'm running an outpatient clinic where I laugh with patients, but sometimes I also cry with them. And they are happy and I'm happy because I can do something. I can really mean something to them. It's meaningful work.
My family, my close friends, I think they very much do have an understanding for it. And that makes it much easier to share with them, like, hey, I've done too much this week, or, oh, it's a bit busy here, is it okay if we go somewhere else? And it's, they understand, it's completely fine. But when it's with people you don't know that well, like, I wouldn't so quickly tell them about it, and I would most often just suck it up and deal with it, right? And then later deal with the consequences myself. So I think in general, like in speaking in society level, I guess something like that, I think the high sensitivity is quite stigmatized, and I don't really dare bring it up like that.
I believe it's very important to include sensitive people in research. It makes sure that we conduct research that is connected to the needs and experiences of sensitive people. I believe it is essential to have impact on sensitive people, on science and society. I come from conducting research on ADHD, and in the ADHD field, experiences of people with ADHD have not always been taken into account, and that led to a lot of missed opportunities, and I really want to make sure that we take these opportunities in the sensitivity field.
How would you describe high sensitivity in one word?
I'm sorry.
Colorful.
Love. I would describe high sensitivity.